So my principal believed me, and he did the next step and he told. Unfortunately, he told the wrong person. My father passed away when I was 3 years old, and my mother struggled to care for my sister and I. A neighbor found us in conditions that were not ideal for children or for anyone really, no running water, no power. So we were removed and placed in foster care. The time that I was in foster care was great. I remember three distinct families. I remember a house with a big garden. I remember them saying I could call them mom and dad. I remember one foster mom teaching me that if you put enough butter on cauliflower, it makes it delicious. And that is a life lesson I have kept with me. But when I was 6 years old, my mom passed away, and that's when things changed. My mom's family stepped in and tried to take care of us, and so we entered into kinship care. A lot of times, biological family is great for kids. They're great caregivers, they're a great extension, and they really do meld with what is best for a child. Unfortunately, my time with care and with my relatives was not that. Some were good, but some were not. It was when relatives hit me. When relatives looked at a small child and decided to choke them because they were frustrated.
One of the things about Helen's story is that it's more common than we'd like to think. That there were people around Helen who saw her as a child, maybe wondered about, you know, gosh, she seems awful sad. Gosh, it seems like she never wants to be at home. Would that raise a question to a reasonable person that something might be going on?
I was in late elementary school and middle school years and tried to reach out to those around me. Teachers, coaches, anyone that would kind of hear my story. First, it was sly things like in my journal in my creative writing class of writing a story and seeing if my teacher would ask me questions about it. At other times, it was being straight out and telling a friend's parent this is what was going on. There was one time I was playing a basketball game and waiting for my game to come up, and one of the moms in the stand, she started to ask more questions and just get to know me. And during that time, I started to share that things weren't good at home. I wasn't safe. And she believed me. And she told me that it wasn't right. She affirmed what I said. But unfortunately, she didn't do anything. And one time, it was even telling the school principal what was going on. And at that point, the school principal did step up and do something. Unfortunately, that something was calling in the relatives that were taking care of me and addressing it straight with them.
Whether you're a mandated reporter or you're just an everyday citizen, it's your opportunity to protect that child by telling the right people. And your telling gives them the information that helps them to go make the investigation so that that child can be kept safe.
There's a lot of things that I'm still learning to deal with as an adult from those times of abuse. There's still certain triggers, wearing necklaces or scarves, fears around, will someone leave me or abandon me if I'm not at my best? But thankfully, God was there. He'd always been there, and he still is. I've been able to finish my schooling, get married to a wonderful man. I never thought I was gonna have someone to call mom and dad, and my husband's parents let me do that. It's amazing what God can do in redeeming. But when I think back of the young version of myself, I long for someone to have fully completed the circle of what should happen. In the space of child welfare, there are many people doing the work, specifically a gentleman, Peter Vanacore. In his work, he came up with this acronym, BAT, B-A-T. B, believe. Believe the child and what they're saying to you. A, affirm. Let them know that this should not be happening to them. And T, tell. In my story, only two happened, believe and affirm. And actually, there was an instance where tell happened, but it was to the wrong people.
It's the agency's responsibility when they receive that phone call for them to collect some information. They need to make sure that that child is safe in that moment. They need to know the name of the child. the address to where the child lives, who the caregivers are in that home. If the child has told you who's the person who's harming them, please tell that. They're also going to want to interview the young person away from the person who's harming them. The worker could come and show up at the school. They'll also want to interview any other child living in the home. As a reporter, you can report anonymously.
You don't have to be afraid that anything will come back to you, but you can be afraid of what will happen for that child. Because when that principal told my relatives what was going on and we got home, things got worse for me. Tell the right people. Call the 1-800-4-A-CHILD hotline.
People on the other end of the line are trained and prepared to receive your information and to walk you through what it is that you have to share about that child and that child's story to protect that child from further abuse or neglect.